So in the last segment, I raised this issue of, can we call everything art, or is there a certain set of characteristics that one can look for in a work of art, and how does one decide? So that is the question I'm going to raise now and try to answer in this segment. There is a professor called Barry Scott. He is from UK. He has written a lot of books on aesthetics. You can go and search more about him on the internet. He has given a set of 10 characteristics, which if it is there, you can say this is a work of art. Okay? So the first one is that the work that you are looking at, work or image, whatever you want to give name, so it should have aesthetic qualities. That again, we'll be talking about it as we go along. So it should have aesthetic qualities. It should have a sense of emotional expression. It should be intellectually challenging. It can be formally complex and coherent. It cannot be chaotic. It has to be coherent. It should have a capacity to convey complex meanings. It should exhibit an individual point of view. It should be an exercise in using creative imagination. It can also be a product of a skill that is passed on from one generation to another generation. And then it can also be a product of a high degree of skill, like how you saw in the other images before. The most importantly, the 10th one is very crucial when it comes to contemporary art, being the product of an intention to make a work of art. So using that sentence, that's how I said nature, or what we see in nature, even though it's colorful, cannot be framed under the name of art. Now we will look at some images and see whether the kind of list that Barry Scott has provided helps us in identifying a work of art or not. When you see an image like this, it has got a high degree of skill, a kind of aesthetic sense that we spoke about, and then it is also bringing a kind of emotional expression. And again, a work like this, it has very high degree of skill, and it has this sense of attraction that you know, you go and see it more closely. It's a very large work, actually. So when compared to the earlier image, this image is not about skill. It is about bringing you a sense of emotional intensity in the way the brush strokes are laid down. And it is not about representing a body as you see it from naked eye, but bringing into it a different kind of reading. It is calling your attention to the physicality of the color application itself. In the earlier work, the color application is smoothened out, so you don't see the mark of a brush and all. Here, it's very visible. So there is a physicality to the whole application. It could also be a result of a traditional way of looking at things in developing content, and also the making part. Like these two sculptures from Indian tradition, they are made in such a way that they are continuing the tradition of the way the image of these women are represented, the proportion, and so on. So there is a certain kind of idealization of the image itself. And if they are cast in bronze, there is a certain way of traditional bronze casting is done. So they are continuing that particular tradition. It could also be an attempt to look at the image from different viewpoints, like what we see on the right hand side, David Hockney's work. It is not about drawing the face from one viewpoint, but going around that and trying to record the different aspects that you see into one work. Or what you see on the left hand side, it is more about making a portrait very idealistic. It is not a realistic portrait. It is not somebody who is there, but how ideally somebody can be seen. So that is the kind of attempt there. So we have tradition, we have in all these works, there is an intention to make a work of art. You see a sense of aesthetics, So all these are coming together. When you compare to all the other images, these two are very different. They are not trying to show a face as you see them, but something more than that, right? If you have a very emotional day, you are very agitated. How does one, you know, express that kind of very agitated mood in a work of art? Or let us say you go to a party and then meet a lot of people and come back. You can't sleep very quickly because all those conversations you had is running in your head. So how do I make a work of such experiences? Not just about showing what is on the surface, but that is the invisible aspect of the human emotions or personality. How does one show it? So there is emotional aspect here, and there is also a sense of creativity involved because you are creating a metaphor for the experience, and again the intention to work of art, creative work of art is there. It could also be looking at body as a very as an object, or it could be looking at the body in a very sarcastic and ironical way, or it could be looking at the body as it is, as things are aging and you're looking at all the wrinkles and all that. A Lucian Freud work is not about escaping, observing the aging aspect. He records every little detail, so it you have to really confront that. So he doesn't whitewash and he doesn't let you go so easily. And a Tracy Emin drawing would be very quick observations of the human proportions and the kind of the way the body can contort and emotionally and things like that. Many of them carry a very complex set of meanings, and they are also intellectually challenging. Like the initial that works that we saw can be just about documenting and recording what is seen, but other works, they demand a certain kind of involvement from the viewer, a certain kind of imagination from the viewer, and they convey a much more complex set of meanings. A work from William D. Kooning, again, is looking at the body and human figure in a very different way. It's about all the emotionally charged strokes, and it also becomes a kind of metaphor for the personality itself. Or a sculpture from Giacometti is about loneliness, about being not attached to the surrounding, and that one person walking in the night. You know, that kind of emotional response one gets from these sculptures. What you see on the left-hand side is a sculpture by Mark Quinn. Now, if I go to a blood test, and then at the end of the day you have a blood report, that is also a portrait of you. Not what is seen from outside, but what is happening inside. How much is your blood sugar and cholesterol and so on and so forth. So Mark Quinn has cast his own face in blood, and it is kept in a cold environment so it doesn't melt. So it's like a double portrait. It is not only the facial features of him that you see there, but it is also the actual blood drawn from him which is there. So it's a very layered kind of attempt. And what you see on the right hand side, Bala's sculpture, what you see there is made from a kind of material that we use in our wardrobes to ward off cockroaches and all that, naphthalene balls that we keep. So the sculpture is made from that material, and that sculpture is located in a glass box, and he has made a very small hole, and over a period of time the sculpture is melting or it's evaporating. And next to that he has kept a cast which is made in fiberglass. So one is a very static kind of image of him, and the other is something that is constantly changing and evaporating. If you take, say, our own personality, what we give it to as a name is static, but the personality is constantly changing. We are aging, our body is renewing itself, and so on. So how does one bring that kind of a very complex idea in a work of art? If you just make somebody sit there, or if you just do a self-portrait, I can't convey that kind of meaning. So Bala and Mark Quinn, they bring that kind of very complex set of meanings by using a different kind of medium, a different kind of visual strategy into their work. We all have this personal bubble. Like if somebody comes very close to us, we get agitated. And especially when you If somebody is not a familiar person, the more he or she comes closer, you want to keep going away. And especially in the Europe and Western countries, the personal bubble is much bigger. How does one make the other person aware of this kind of personal bubble or this idea of touching as a very, very sensitive act, which you want to do with lot of care? So Marina is a performance artist. This performance was made in a gallery. She and her partner Ule, they stood naked in the gallery entrance. And the performance was, you had to touch them and pass through. And in the process, you became very, very aware of the body, the nakedness and the touch itself. And again, this kind of very complex idea, one cannot communicate in a conventional medium. So again, if I go back to the list, it is not about skill, it is not about aesthetic sense, because there is nothing like a formal composition here, but it's a very complex idea and there is an intention to create a work of art. So we'll have to choose from the list what suits that particular kind of artwork that we are seeing, or an image also. Now, this is the Marcel Duchamp urinal, which he signed as his work, and it was sent for an exhibition. The idea behind such an act was that if I say this is work of art, it is work of art. The artist's intention and authorship is more important than actually sitting and drawing something or sculpting something. So he brought this entire idea of conceptual art and other ideas into the work of art. So it's a very crucial work in the modern art. So that is displayed in a museum. And now the moment you put up something in a museum, it gets an aura. And you put up a box around that, it becomes even more mystical, because you can't touch, you are told to remove your backpack in the entrance, and constantly you are reminded these are very precious artworks, don't touch them, there is a yellow band there to stop you from going. So that creates this kind of mystical presence for a work of art in a gallery or a museum. And he was kind of exploiting that status that is given by the museum to work of art. And he said, this is my work, and then it was kept in a museum. And these two Chinese artists, they went there and they peed on that. They said this was an ordinary urinal. This artist signed it and then he made an artwork out of that. Now we will reclaim its ordinariness and make it an ordinary object. So this process of making something into a work of art and then reclaiming it back, that also can be seen here. Again, it's a set of complex ideas, and then an intention to create a work of art that is operating behind all this. And artists don't stop there. Artists love shocking, and they want to do very provocative kind of work, and they want to do very mischievous kind of work, very irreverent kind of work. So Manzoni, Piero Manzoni, he created this kind of boxes where an exact amount of his shit was packed in that. It was signed and then numbered and sold. It was a statement about the kind of consumerist society that we are going around, where everything is given a certain value and then it is saleable and so on. And in fact, people bought it. It was bought by museums and collectors. So it became a kind of very defiant kind of act, and also very sarcastic comment on the kind of consumerist tendency which has seeped into the world of art also. And the other side, you see, it's an inflatable sculpture by Paul McCarthy, and he calls it complicated shit. A museum invited him to do a work of art, and on the opening day, you have this big shit there, which nobody expected. So there were two kind of aspects to this work. One is that we have this taboo that you can't create work of art about some subjects, and they are yuck and things like that. And also, by calling it complicated shit, he was also commenting in a sideways about the artistic practice itself, where it is such a complicated work of art that you need all kinds of interventions and explanations to be understood and appreciated. So there was a double strategy there. So again, can we call this a work of art? I would say yes, because he has a very complex set of ideas that are being promoted and projected through this. And then there is also an intention. Now, in performance art, all kinds of strategies are used. This is a Russian artist, and he was protesting against the state oppression. So he nailed himself and sat in front of the main tourist attraction there, and people saw him, photographed him, and so it became a kind of statement. It's using your own body instead of using other kind of mediums to create a work of art. So the question is, what is the ecosystem of a art world? And what is the process of validation? Are there individuals and institutions involved? So basically, if I'm an artist, let's say I'm doing some work, and I have a set of work, then I call my friend. And then the friend says, no, it's very nice. And you get one round of validation. Then you want to exhibit it. And when you exhibit it, maybe the gallery will give you a space, or you can hire the space, and people will come and see that. And then people will say, it's a very good work, or I like it, and so on. So one more round of validation comes to it. And then maybe some newspaper will write about it, and somebody will buy that. So like this, circle by circle, the artist is moving from the periphery to the center. And then somebody will make a publication or a book about you, somebody will make a video, and then your work will go into museum. So slowly it is being accepted and validated by more than one set of people. The more it's validated, more it is accepted. So that is the kind of process or the ecosystem that happens in the art world. And if you look at it closely, there is not one kind of art world. There are many kinds of multiple happenings in the world. Let's say if you're doing one kind of work, there'll be people who like you or your work, and then they buy it and then write about it. Another kind of work, they may not agree, but there'll be another kind of set of people who will support that, and then they'll enjoy it and so on. So if you look at the bigger picture, the ecosystem has got multiple centers and multiple set of people who are accepting and validating that kind of art practice. So that's how the art world works. That's why I've said journey from periphery to the center. And when you have an award from an academy, or if you have a retrospective in a major museum, that means you have really arrived at the center of the art world. But there are a lot of artists who reject this kind of journey also. They stay away from this system and they do a different kind of work. That is also possible. There are multiple outcomes from the same experience. We saw how if an artist is responding to body, the experience of a body, looking at body, somebody can emphasize the outer proportions and anatomy and so on, but somebody can look at the emotional aspect of it, or somebody can look at the kind of ephemeral character of a body, and so on. So there is always this multiple outcomes possible from the same experience. And it is called anekanta, that means multiple endings. There is always polyphony, or multiple voices and diversity in art world. There is no way everybody can do one kind of art, then it's a very boring kind of situation. So you will see different artists practicing different kind of strategies and using different kind of languages. And they all involve in non-linear thinking. They don't think like a straight line, which is a very scientific way of doing. You have one specific question and then very specific right answer for that. But in the art world, there is no such specific answers. There is not even a right or wrong in art world. Whether you are using optimal kind of answers to whatever is experience you are getting, and are you able to make a very interesting and rich artwork? And then most of the artists hold a very non-conformist position. That means they don't agree rules and regulations so easily. They tend to break away from that very easily and make their own rules, bend the rules and so on. So that is a non-conformist position. And there is always a sense of doubt, and there is a sense of contradiction in the artwork and in the artist. All these are not resolved. We don't tend to see artists as a straightforward, straight-jacketed person, but a lot of contradictions which are built within the personality and the practice. And he also has a sense of rebel, as I said before, to resist and question everything that comes in front of him. Now, very briefly, I want to touch upon this idea of what is beauty. We tend to, say, oh, this is beautiful, that is beautiful, and so on. And we use the word beauty in a very casual way. So you can probe a little bit and see whether this is there a universal definition of beauty, or can it be more layered and very nuanced kind of understanding. The moment you start probing a little bit, then you realize this idea of beauty is based on our upbringing, our social structures, economical structures, or the political leaning that you have, and so on and so forth. So it is not a very easy thing to decide whether something is beautiful or not, straightforward. Especially the moment you start moving away from this understanding that only what you see through eye is beautiful, then you'll start opening up a new set of imagery, a new set of understanding. Now what you see here is a portion of a Botticelli painting, and you will realize that centuries later, the kind of body proportion that is appreciated in the Western universe is very similar. And because of our colonial experience, we have this great attraction for a fair skin and a certain kind of body proportion and all. And that shows up in the kind of choices that we make. Like what you see on the glucose biscuit pocket is not the kind of baby here, but another kind of baby, more fair and plump and all, that is in a way given to us from our colonial experience. And most of us, we tend to appreciate or get attracted to very pleasant kind of imagery than what can be very disturbing. On the left hand side, what you see here is Buddha while he was starving for enlightenment. You show these two images to people and they tend to say, don't show it to me, they want to see the other side. Or if I show these two images of one side Bhairava, a aspect of Shiva, and then Shiva Tandava, they would most probably want to see this and not the other side. So whatever is seen as little more disturbing or something that is questioning, people don't want to see that so deeply, or they don't want to even see that. So this idea of replacing pleasantness with beauty, we have to start questioning that. Some of these are different images from different cultures. So that is from the Yakshagana Bhutakola from the South Canara, and this is from the South African mask. That is from the a small sect of people who put a lot of tattoos on their bodies and then piercing and all that. For somebody who is not part of that group, that is not acceptable, or that is not seen as a beautiful gesture. But somebody, let's say, who is part of that, you can't use the word cult, but say group or people who are interested in that, then they would be very appreciative of the kind of beauty that they see there. And again, entire body tattooing. And then when you see the images from the African tribal gear, many people don't want to see them, and they think it is ugly. This premise of what is pleasant and what is beautiful and what is ugly comes from the upbringing, from the social structures we live in. If you are looking at a work of art in a little more serious way, one has to go beyond the immediate responses to what is beautiful and what is pleasant, and look at a different kind of aspect of a work of art to decide whether it is beautiful or not. This particular work of Hokusai, it is actually a tragic story. There is this big wave coming up, and then all these boat riders will be most probably be dead by the time the wave will come and hit them. It's a tragical story, but we say it's a beautiful work. Why? Because of the way the painting is composed. How the imagery or the entrance for the viewer comes from that corner, then it goes up, and then it takes a big leap and comes down. And then the kind of difference of scale that makes those people very small. And then the more you look at those waves, you start seeing them as monstrous kind of tentacles which are coming to eat them. The more you see them, you'll also start seeing them like a creature, not as a wave. And the wave is so big, Mount Fuji itself is looking smaller. So the artist is really telling you a very interesting story, but it's a tragic story, and the way it is being told is beautiful. That is why people pay to go and enjoy horror stories, horror movies, right? Murder movies, when there is lot of blood, lot of killing and all. If our idea of beauty and enjoyment was only limited to what is pleasant, then we would not do that. So at a certain level, we start enjoying the narrative style, the structure, and all the other aspects of the work of art that is going behind. So beauty is not just about what is pleasing to the eye. It can be about something about a work of art that is transporting that viewer to another state of mind. And for that moment, you are watching a movie, you are not aware of the outside world. You are transported to that particular time and era whenever that is happening. Only at the end of the movie, you realize you have to come back and then address your real life. So in that sense, there is a psychic distance that is built between the observer and the work of art. At some remote corner of your mind, you know that's a work of art, or a novel, or a movie, but you still enjoy it as though it is real. So there is a certain kind of disbelief that is working there, and to accept the whole situation. In the Indian thinking, Indian aesthetic theories, we have this Navarasa, or the nine emotions. So we have Shringara, which is romance, Hasya, which is laughter, Raudram, that is fury, Karunyam, compassion, Bibhatsa, that is disgust, Bhayanakam, that is horror, Viram, that is heroism, Adbhutam is wonder, Shanta, that is peace. These are the large archetypes under which you can, accommodate most of the human emotions. But this is a large template that is worked out by the ancient people, which works fairly well. And within that, you can find a structure for a work of art. Even though you are looking at horror, the scene can be horror, but it can be a very beautiful work of art, or a play, or a movie, so on and so forth. So there are no taboos when it comes to what kind of imagery can be presented in a work of art, or what can be a subject or a valid subject for a work of art. It can be a dewdrop, or it can be the darkest recess of a human mind, which is evil, which is deeply criminal and things like that. That can also be a subject for a work of art. So you can't say this is I don't want to see this. This is not beautiful. You'll have to shift your idea of beauty more towards how it is organized and how it is being narrated. So beauty is about the content that is communicated. We spoke about this. It's about the composition and the formal elements. A very important thing is this idea of unity of form, material and content. I have something to say. So what kind of medium I'm using and what kind of form I'm generating to convey that. So this unity of form, material and content, especially in contemporary art, is very crucial. You will see how that works in the coming segments. Even though I have a very good content, but if I'm not using the right kind of form or material, it may not become a very powerful work of art. So the artist has to have a fair amount of right judgment about what to use where and what kind of material to use to bring out the content in a very effective way. It is also about beauty of unique ideas and languages. It may not be something that you saw before, so you get attracted. So that brings a sense of beauty. It is also about how an artist is positioning herself in an existing language. As I said before, as an artist, you are using the existing visual language, but within that, what is that extra you are adding? What is that new dimension that you are bringing about? That brings a sense of beauty. If you have enjoyed watching this video, please press like button. To see more such videos, subscribe to our channel. Thank you.